senior colleagues and friends. I'm sure all of you have been hearing about neurosurgery probably even before I was born. But then, nowadays, neurosurgery has expanded in many ways, and I'm sure all of you know about pediatric neurosurgery, spine surgery, things like that. This is a new development in neurosurgery, which I'm trying to pioneer in this country. And as I go through, you'll understand why I use the word pioneer. Probably it may not be appropriate, but I think, yes, it may be yes. Basically, you know, we all know about situations where, you know, patients come, I'm sure all of you have heard a situation where a patient is after a severe head injury in the hospital, unconscious, is not responding to anything, is on adrenaline drip or the dopamine drip and all that. But the doctors, the neurosurgeon comes and tell you the scan is normal. So I'm sure at least some of you must be wondering why is this. That's because, unlike other organs, in the brain, the structure of the function may not always go to well. And I am trying to operate on those type of patients with a normal investigations.
Last one.
Yeah. Okay, what do I do? I do basically four types of surgeries. One is called deep brain stimulation, where I stimulate various deep nuclei. This includes for conditions like movement disorder, like Parkinson's disease, some psychiatric problems like OCD, depression. I operate for alcoholism. I operate for various types of chronic pains, including what's called central post-op pain. I operate for epilepsy. And now started operating for failed bariatric surgeries, obesity to failed bariatric surgeries. Talking to patients for surgery for autism and schizophrenia. And I also went, I just saw a senior pediatrician, he must be interested. I do a lot of intrathecal pumps for spasticity, that's intrathecal baclofen pumps for spasticity, intrathecal morphine pumps for various types of pains. Patients in persistent vegetative state, by surgery, we can make them conscious nowadays. And the other thing is spinal cord stimulation. I was just describing when I was a cardiologist stopped. I operate for refractory angina. Just I operate on the nerves going to the heart to give them a normal life in this type of very, very diffuse triple vessel disease. I operate for failed back syndromes, painful type of neuropathy, all these pain conditions. The other surgery I do is called sacral nerve stimulation because, you know, I'm sure all of you know neurogenic bladders. Always neurogenic bladder sees in a patient is condemned to a very miserable life. But now we can operate these patients and give them a normal life. And finally, I also do epilepsy surgery. So I just brush through all this. What is deep brain stimulation? Indications include movement disorders, psychiatric disorders, alcoholism, epilepsy, etc. This involves introducing high-tech electrodes into various specific targets of the brain. The results are very good and properly selected patients. All my surgeries are approved by all organizations, including the CGHS, ESI, FDA, all this stuff. So, it's not like the short tech and midwaker and moody waker and then technical. It's not like stem cells and all that. It's all approved surgeries. And then, but it's my job to ensure that the patient has tried all non-surgical treatments sufficiently and this has failed. Indications for surgery in Parkinson's disease, advanced disease, medication refractory symptoms, 10 years after diagnosis. This is very important. Patient understand and accept the therapy. So this, of course, as all of you know, is the prone section of the brain. The area for Parkinson's disease which we target or which we stimulate is called the subthalamic region. This is here, and this is the red one is called the substantia nigra. I'm sure all of you know substantia nigra, where you get this dopamine which is the culprit in Parkinson's disease. So this is the subthalamic region. And for other conditions like dystonia and all that, we target this area, the glomus spinalis interna. So like that, there are various targets which we use. This is a picture of the electrode, it has got four contact points, and like our cardiac pacemaker, it's also a pacemaker, which is kept infraclavicular. During surgery, in fact, the surgeries are very long surgeries, go on for 18, 20 hours, and it's done under local anesthesia. In fact, if anybody is interested in seeing surgery, we are doing the next one on Wednesday, you can come. Most of the patients will be reading novels or watching TV and all while I am operating, because I want to continuously assess the patient during surgery. And this is one assessment where I do continuously recording, micro-electro recordings from the brain. So when you record from the brain, these are the various pictures you get. From the upper thalamus, you get like this. From the subthalamic nucleus, you get like this. From the substantia nigra, you get this picture. So like that, every organ has a different picture. Of course, this, in the theater, this looks like this. So how do I know I'm in the correct position? Because, you know, these structures are very near me, you know. If you go a little medially, the patient will start seeing double. If you go a little laterally, millimeters matter. If you go a little laterally, the patient will have hemiplegia. So like that, it's very, very complicated. So how do I know I'm in the correct direction? I use this. If you too posterior, the patient will have paresthesia. If it's too anterior, the patient will have muscle contractions because the corticospinal tract that gets stimulated. If I have too medial, the patient will have diplopia and the eyes will close and there will be deviation of the eyes in order. So this is how I find out whether I'm in the correct place. Most of the symptoms improve from bradykinesia. Just think Parkinson as an example because you know it's the most common disease we all see. Independence and quality of life are substantially improved and very, very, very minimum cognitive. In the last 12 years I'm operating, I've never had any patient come back to me for cognitive. In fact, I beg many patients to come and also never see me whether I am there. They never come back. Because they are slow. This is the X-ray picture. You can see the electrodes here. And this is for the one going to the back. If I go to pain, which is the other thing which I treat, because some of this you already know, pain is probably the most common symptom. I'm sure most of you, the common symptom you treat is pain. When pain persists or occurs for more than 6 months, it is defined as chronic pain. The two most severe chronic pain syndromes are cancer pain and brain back syndromes. And then there are other painful conditions like chronic pancreatitis, migraine, things like that. This is very important. This is what's called the WHO analgesic ladder. The WHO described this in 1986, and all of us are expected to follow this for pain management. Here, the steps, the first step is basically, you know, after diagnosis, you try all the over-the-counter pain medications. If this doesn't work, you go to the second step of NSAIDs and nerve blocks and psychological, other psychiatrists, psychologists and all that. If this doesn't work, you go to higher levels like opioids or thermal procedures, we call it TARP lesioning, things like that. Most of the patients, 80-85%, even up to 90% of patients don't require anything more because they become well with these things. But there are occasional patients who may not benefit from any of this. So for that, we go to the surgical procedures, which is either neurostimulation or implantable drug pumps. So the two surgeries which we do for surgery for pain, chronic pain, is one is intrathecal morphine pumps for cancer pain, failed back syndrome, and all these other conditions. And then spinal cord syndrome, where I use it for failed back syndrome, refractory angina, diabetic neuropathy, peripheral vascular disease, complex renal brittle disease. So many, there's so many indications like this. This is a picture of the pump. This pump is kept under the skin of the abdomen. It's such a subcutaneously placed. And then the other end goes into the CSF, and the drug is delivered continuously. There's many drugs which are delivered from the pump. The advantages of the pump that refilling is very easy. You can, just like we do a subcutaneous injection, we can give it, we can refill the pump. And the pump is very good in that it gives an alarm if when it is going to become empty, and it's so many advantages with the pump. And this is how the spinal cord solution looks like. This is the one which we use for cardiac surgery. All these PCIs and most of them don't work. Most of the patients come back within 6 months and see their IJM. So when we do the surgery, in fact, there are studies which have shown that spinal cord stimulation and bypass surgery results are almost equal. And second thing is what our cardiologists and cardiac surgeons don't generally mention, but we neurosurgeons know is, it's a huge amount of intracerebral hematomas after cardiac surgery, because most of the patients put on clopidogrel and all that. And a lot of patients come back with subdural hematomas, intracerebral bleeds and all that. In my surgery, it doesn't happen. And my surgery is very simple procedure. Baclofen pump is done for all types of spasticity, cerebral palsy, distorted cerebral palsy, vegetative spinocerebral degeneration, all that. And the biggest advantage of my surgery, for example, if somebody is a patient with cerebral palsy comes to me, I just don't operate immediately. I put 1 ml of baclofen or morphine or whatever it is into the CSF by the lumbar puncture and see whether the patient is going to benefit or not. If the patient benefits, then only I operate. This is how it looks like. And this is how the spinal cord solution looks like. Surgery for epilepsy, I'm sure all of you have heard of the surgery for epilepsy. 30-40% of patients can be treated surgically. A concordant clinical, radiological, electrophysiological, and the psychological parameters are very important. The commonest is temporal lobectomy, but other surgeries like corpus callosotomy, recently are all done. These are all various other surgeries. Finally, we go to the surgery for sphincter disturbances. S234 is a nerves control the external sphincters. So, this stimulating these nerves helps in controlling the sphincters. Indications include overactive bladder, non-obstructive retention, fecal incontinence, irritable bowel, severe intractable pelvic pain in women, constipation, all these things. Again, just like after my surgeries, we always do a trial before the original surgery. It's not intended for mechanical obstruction and it is not indicated for treatment of stress incontinence. This is how the electrode looks like. There are 4 connect points, 3 times which hold on to the pelvic fascia. And again, just like that on previous examination. And this is a table I use to see whether I'm in the right correct position. This is how the post-op X-ray looks like. Some recent advances with peripheral nerve stimulation for migraine, frenic nerve stimulation for diaphragmatic failure, and some of these new surgeries. Finally, I just come to one interesting thing. This area of the brain is called the nucleus accumbens, and this, the psychiatrist Dr. Mani and all will know the importance of this nucleus. This is part of the reward circuit. Whatever we do, there's a reward. Even dressing, even whatever we do, eating, everything, there's a reward. And in some people, this reward circuit overacts. And it is these people who end up in addictions and unwanted activities. So if somebody is drinking too much or taking too much drugs or eating too much and becoming fat and all that, if you are able to stimulate the nucleus accumbens, they just get out of this problem. So I am regularly operating for alcoholism. What I do is, just like I showed in the previous one of the pictures, I put two electrodes into the nucleus accumbens here, and these people lose a craving for drinking or addiction. Even especially heroin addiction, I know they just forget about it.
For the addiction, what are the side effects, sir?
Not much, madam, because as I don't know whether you saw the electrode in the first picture, there are four contact points. Some patients get into hypomania, but then when you adjust the electrodes, you adjust the current, there are so many parameters which I can adjust, the current, the resistance, so many stimulation I can adjust. So usually hypomania occurs, but then it can be corrected immediately, almost immediately.
Nowadays, we see this is quite a lot of benzodiazepine addiction and alprazolam addiction. These are the medicines that are available freely, right? And without prescriptions. So, I see a lot of people coming with alprazolam addiction. Using alprazolam for 10 years, 20 years. So how do you handle that? Do you have
any? I have never had any patient like that, so I don't know. But I think probably just never.
Any treatment for social media addiction?
Most of the addiction is, but no, probably in future, we can probably think of it. Now probably social media addiction may not be a big issue as such, but probably in the present generation grow bigger, I think they are going to be in real trouble. Probably that time alcohol and all may become less, and the social media may become more.
No, sir. Now they've been classified as a disease, internet addiction as such. So
possible.
Treatment. So
possible, sir. Over
so
a period of
time. The infant stage, it is a full grown disease, it is classified in ICD-10 itself as a disease.
Okay.
No, sir, I want to is also
no, but I have not attempted. At least, you know, nobody has come to me saying that, you know, I am addicted to social media. Probably 10 years down the line, I may have.
Sir,
as a result of Parkinson's,
when you get results,
yes.
Is there any good surgery for prion disease, two surgical disease, where there is cognitive dysfunction?
No, sir. Sir, one of the biggest contraindications for my surgery is cognitive decline. So suppose I have a patient, I always send them to a neuropsychologist for a detailed psychometry, and if the psychometry shows there is either depression or dementia, we don't know.
Sir, you mentioned vegetative state patients get better.
Sorry.
Yes. How do they get better?
Okay, madam, that is see, actually, he is in a hurry, so I will.
I am not in a hurry.
Because it will take some time. Madam, when we are all sleeping, what do? We put off lights, we put off TV, we put the fan. You know why? Because we want the reticular activating system in our brain to sleep. Okay. With my surgery, I activate the reticular. Stimulate the reticular activating system so that they come back.
You put the slide on addiction.
The last one?
And I will ask you many questions.
He is one. See, I came to Chennai in 2009. He is one of the first senior doctor I met in Chennai. Because Professor Kalyanaram is like a father figure to me. And he only invited me to Chennai. Yes, please.
See, alcoholism is so rampant now. What is the cost of this study?
the cost of the surgery is around 10 lakhs. But it is always better to go for this surgery than go for a liver transplant with Mohammed Raila for 16 lakhs.
See, there is now a social agitation against alcoholism. You are seeing every day ladies attacking the asthma shops throughout the state. This has not become a telling phenomenon because the youngsters are not drinking. When the students and youngsters are not drinking, this has become a phenomenon because of the ladies only. Not becoming a phenomenon. Now we have to offer the willing alcoholic persons all options of treatment. One option of treatment, I closely work with our president of the money, we are using the drugs, counseling, etc., etc. Why can't this be made cheaper and present as an option for the willing candidates?
Sir, unfortunately, the cost, as I told you, out of this 10 lakhs, 8 lakhs is for the implants. And the implant is made by one monopoly company. I have tried in various ways. I am working with many browsers and IIT and all that to build that. So the battery is a problem, sir. These electrodes are very simple, but the battery is very difficult to, you know, I have talked to many, this thing, I have even went to Indian Institute of Science. There is one Mr. Who is from Chennai. So we are all trying in various ways, but at the moment, because this company is monopoly product and Medtronic, I know it's a bigger giant. As individuals, I think probably we may not be able to fight with that.
We have to write to Modi, sir. We have to write to Mr. Modi.
Alcoholism is destroying our society.
Yes,
destroying our society.
Like whilst this also has. We have to write to them and bring down the cost of that.
Perhaps we will take steps.
We love you.
Thank you very much, sir. Now I request Dr. Srinivasa Varma to give a certificate of appreciation to Dr. Amrita.